That's why dictator Immanuel Kant, that's why neo-Kantians, Stambler, Mahatma Gandhi, Jay Prakash Narayan, and all these people are neo-Kantians. So particularly Mahatma Gandhi, somebody referred about Mahatma Gandhi. So when he was prosecuted for the offense of sedition, so judge stood up when the accused was introduced to the court. It was shown in Gandhi cinema also. So when judge stood up as a mark of respect to the great soul, all the members in the hall, advocates and other people stood up as a mark of respect. The first question judge asked Mahatma Gandhi was that, being a lawyer, didn't you know violation of the law of the land attracts punishment? Then he replied, yes, I know. Violation of law of the land is offense. I know as a lawyer. At the same time, the law which is draconian one, which is against my conscience, which is against my reason, need not be followed. That's why I surrender, I did not follow your law. At the same time, I surrender for the punishment. So he does not want to escape from the punishment. The same analogy was made by Socrates. So when Socrates was punished for the offense of spoiling the youth, all his followers told him, we can manage the judge and other people and we will make you escape from the Athens. But Socrates replied, so for now this political state gave me the protection. Greek city-states, every city itself is a state. In India also, we have 16 Mahajanapadas. Prior to the ascendance of Magadha, all these 16 Mahajanapadas where republican form of governments were there. The initial development of the political state and human societies in primitive stage of ancient India were more democratic one. The king was elected. Out of these 16 Mahajanapadas, Magadha was ascended. Magadha was emerged as a strong political state. From there, you have a dictatorial form of other Indian dynasty after dynasty. We know the history. So until the Britishers left India, we were under the the authoritarian form of government. In one form or other form, we had authoritarian form of government. That's why the human societies moved from authoritarian form of governments, dictatorial form of governments, to democratic form of governments. If democracy fails, the result is anarchy. So to avoid anarchy, to avoid utter disorder, willy-nilly, the human societies stick to democracy, even though it is worst form of government because of its own weaknesses within the system. In democracy, we have to allow all the opinions and other things, so the possibility is there. So that's why the entire natural law philosophy is the crux, fulcrum of the human rights jurisprudence. Next one. So the political system and even that law as system of rules, hierarchy of norms, there also the minimum content of morality was taken into consideration by the rulers. So as far as human rights jurisprudence is concerned, under constitution you have human rights, fundamental rights and direct principles of state policy. And if a problem is there beyond your constitutionally guaranteed fundamental rights and directive principles, the other rights can also be protected in the name of Article 21. So the any new right is emerged, it should be protected. That is what is the spirit of human rights under Constitution of India. So beyond that, the human rights culture, the human rights jurisprudence, when you are thinking of that, actually, you have justice. So justice then is given. Justice and unwell. So justice as fairness, justice as removal of inequalities, justice as improvement of human capabilities, and justice as legal justice, natural justice, and distributive and corrective tool of justice. Actually, as far as justice is concerned, John Rawls wrote a book, Theory of Justice. Of course, previously ancient natural law thinking, medieval natural law thinking, and modern natural law thinking like Kant and neo-Kantians. In 1973, John Rawls wrote a book, Theory of Justice. So he understood the justice in two principles. Justice can be achieved through equality. Second principle is justice can be achieved through liberty. So libertarian principle, equality principle. In social democracy, justice is the end value. Through equality, justice can be achieved. In liberal democracy, justice is an end value. Through liberty, you can achieve the justice. Equality is a tool to achieve justice in social democracy. Under Indian Constitution of India, under Indian Constitution, we have a socialistic pattern of society. So social democracy was designed. That's why equality-oriented tools were developed for the understanding of the concept of justice, for achieving the particular justice in the society. But the problem is, previously some people also referred about this 1991 post-globalization era, the liberalization era, LPG, liberalization, globalization and privatization. The problem came in India, the liberal democracy, Western liberal democracy, political liberalism. So where liberty is given more importance. Actually, if you go deeper and deeper, equality and liberty are sworn enemies. If you want to implement liberty, you cannot achieve equality. So you have to give freedom. You have to give freedom to each and every human being. So one person who is capable of earning 1,000 crores can earn 1,000 crores. Another person may suffer with poverty. So in a liberty-oriented society, in an equality-oriented society, there is some rationalized procedure and policies where liberty is sacrificed. Say, example, reservations. 50% reservation, 50% meritorian principle. So if in a liberty-oriented society, 100% meritorian principle. So because we are implementing this protective discrimination, equality is the rule. So because equality is there, you can implement reservation. In a liberty-oriented society, there is no meaning of such type of putting reservations on the implementation of meritorian principle. Why this particular enhancement of reservation was opposed? The Supreme Court fixed that rule. Right from Balaji to Vasanta Kumar to Indra Shahani, several experiments were made by the governments as well as approval of the Supreme Court of various methods. Ultimately, Supreme Court put a check on this particular. Yes, you have 50% for meritorian principle and 50% for reservation. You cannot increase reservation beyond 50%. You can adjust to give any reservation to anybody within this 50%. So that aspect is there. But the Constitution of India, which is designed to implement equality principle, to remove inequalities and others, was all of a sudden changed. A somersault was taken. So liberty was all of a sudden created. The role of state was diminished. So disinvestment or golden shake hand or foreign investment, whatever it may be, these are all the principles or policies against the real constitutional spirit. So, but without changing a single word of the Constitution, all these were made possible by the respective governments. That reason was also there because of various other policies. So, in that respect, either you have to achieve the justice through equality or you have to achieve justice through liberty. So, John Rawls developed these two theories, and for him, justice is nothing but reflexive equilibrium. You do not do the thing which cannot be accepted by you to be done to you by the other. నువ్వు ఎదటివాడికి ఎదటివాడిని నీకు ఏం చేయకూడదు అనుకున్నావో నువ్వు ఎదటివాడికి చేయి. దట్ ఈజ్ రిఫ్లెక్సివ్ ఈక్విలిబ్రియం. సో జస్టిస్ ఈజ్ ఫెయిర్నెస్. సో ఆఫ్టర్ దట్ మార్తా నాస్వామ్, ఎ పర్సన్ హూజ్ ఎకనామిక్ ప్రిన్సిపల్ వాజ్ యాక్సెప్టెడ్ బై ది యునైటెడ్ నేషన్స్ అంటిల్ దెన్ ఇన్ ఆర్డర్ టు ఐడెంటిఫై ది డెవలప్మెంట్ ఇండెక్స్, National Development Index, until this particular formula, only the GDP, gross domestic produce, was taken into consideration. Under that, rich countries, developed countries, developing countries, underdeveloped countries. But because of this formula, they identified, no doubt, giving human rights and feeling that everybody has human rights is excellent. But without providing minimum facility, minimum capability to a human being, how can you understand that particular human being is enjoying all the human rights? So without having primary education, without having food security, without having primary health, how can you expect that a human being can enjoy all the human rights? When he is not in a position to move, how can he enjoy all the rights? So NASPAM developed these human capabilities. Before human rights, before you talk about human rights, you talk about human capabilities. It is the primary duty of the political state. It is the primary duty of any progressive society that you have these human capabilities to be achieved by all the people. That's why primary health, primary education, food security were given more importance from 2000 onwards. So these are the minimum core human rights. So first of all, you implement these to all the people. So human capabilities before human rights. So she wrote a book on frontiers of justice. So several attempts were made to understand what is justice. So justice is such a dynamic concept. And Ramayana concept of justice, Eshma concept of justice and sovereignty, and Greek concept of justice and Roman concept of justice. Justice is a just thing. So what is just? Just to you may not be just to me. Just to me may not be just to the other. Whereas the commonality, as I said, the categorical imperative of the concept to the court, just to get the approval of the court by way of judgment about his opinion about that particular property. Bad man approach. So Oliver Wendell Holmes, who is the profounder of this American realism. So why should you study law? You have to study the behavior of the judge. So realistic, what is really going on in the court? So in India also several studies were conducted. So in that context he said, law is not logic. It is human experience. Law is not a mathematical sum to solve. It is a painting to paint. The quality of painting depends upon the painter. So law is like a painting. So in that context we have to understand. So in that context in India also we have Rajiv Dhawan is there, Upendra Bakshi, Madhav Menon and all these particular jurists, Krishnayar and all these people developed various what we say methods and approaches and ideologies to have an effective implementation of the rights in general, the core human rights in particular. So the famous statement of Upendra Bakshi is, thinking in order to protect the human rights in a particular society, thinking humanity should suffer. Suffering humanity should think. Thinking humanity, the intellectuals, the judges, the lawyers, the teachers, the public have to suffer to think, suffer to create a new idea. Thinking humanity should suffer. Intellectuals should suffer to create a new ideology for the common good. Whereas suffering humanity, the underprivileged, the less privileged, the what we say, the exploited classes, all these have to know, have to think about their suffering. Suffering humanity should think. The worker who is not getting the salary should think why he should not get the salary. A woman who is suffering about the status of her own regarding the security and other aspects should think about her suffering. So that's why he concluded the human rights jurisprudence in these particular two phrases. Thinking humanity should suffer to create new ideology to solve the problems. suffering humanity should think about their suffering. So thinking humanity should suffer, suffering humanity should think. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. క్లాస్ లోని అందరూ కూడా స్టూడెంట్స్ చాలా శ్రద్ధగా విన్నారు. అదే పేషెన్సీ కూడా మొత్తం ఉదయం నుంచి ఇప్పటి వరకు చాలా పేషెన్సీగా ఉండి ఈ ప్రోగ్రామ్ సక్సెస్ చేసినందుకు మీ అందరికీ కూడా మనస్ఫూర్తిగా ధన్యవాదాలు తెలియజేస్తున్నాను. Thank you very much to all.